السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. تاني.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي
إن الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا إنه من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ولن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير وأشهد أن محمدًا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وكشف الله به الغمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه الله اليقين أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله ومن أصدق من الله حديثًا وإن خير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. In the name of Allah, the all merciful, the ever merciful, and the all praise and the blessings and salutations of all the prophets and messengers from Adam alayhi salam to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters, tubtum wa taba mamshakum wa tabawwa'tum min al-jannati ghurafan wa manazila. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of your steps to the masjid. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you the peace and sincerity. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar. La ilaha illallah. Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar. Wa lillahi alhamd. الله أكبر كبيرا والحمد لله كثيرا وسبحان الله العظيم بكرة وأصيلا اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت على الحق أقدامنا يا رب العالمين. My brothers and sisters, Ramadan is over. But the actions of Ramadan are not. And inshallah, today we will focus slightly about this. We talked in the Eid and in the Jum'ah after the Eid about the details or some of the things that we can continue after Ramadan. And what are the things that we talked also about, the things that Ramadan is special with. But Ramadan is the push and is the beginning of a practice that needs to be altered in the right way. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described Ramadan, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. One of the characteristics of Ramadan, that it is the month of the Quran. And also when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned fasting, and كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامِ, and here he's specifically talking about the obligatory fasting, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ means has been instructed upon you. So that's specifically about the month of Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eventually said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So we said, Ramadan is the month of the Qur'an. شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنُ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. Ramadan, the month of Ramadan, is the month when the Qur'an has been revealed. For what purpose? هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ, guidance to the people. So inshallah, we will focus more about this. What was special about Ramadan that after 10 days, today is the 9th day of Shawwal. After 9 days after Ramadan was over, what was special about Ramadan that we still do? That's the question of today, inshallah. What was special about Ramadan? We learned that what was special about Ramadan, the fasting. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us how we continue the habit of fasting. By hadith rawahu Abu Ayyub, reported in At-Tirmidhi, when he said, مَنْ صَامَ رَمَضَانَ ثُمَّ أَتْبَعَهُ بِسِتٍ مِّنْ شَوَالٍ فَكَأَنَّمَا صَامَ الدَّهْرَ كُلَّهُ. Whoever fasted Ramadan, then followed Ramadan by 6 days in Shawwal, which is the month that we are in now, the month right after Ramadan. If you fast 6 days, voluntary fasting, in Shawwal, after you finish Ramadan, فَكَأَنَّمَا, as if that person did what? صَامَ, fasted the whole year. فَكَأَنَّمَا صَامَ الدَّهْرَ كُلَّ. And the ulama said, they've been observing the hadith, and what the hadith means. They said, usually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. Whoever does a good deed is followed, this good deed is counted as 10. So he said, Ramadan is a month of 30 days of fasting, or sometimes 29 days, but the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, شَهْرَانِ لَا يُنْقَصَانِ مِنْ أَجْرِهِمَا رَمَضَانُ وَذِي الْحِجَّةِ. So whether it's 29 days or 30 days is counted before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a complete month. So whoever fasted Ramadan 30 days multiplied by 10 is 300 days. And then فَأَتْبَعَهُ بِسِتٍ مِّنْ شَوَالٍ, then fasted 6 days in Shawwal, which is multiplied by 10, is counted 60 days. And the Islamic calendar year is between 354 to 360 days. So as if you fasted the whole year. That's in terms of the habit of fasting that was Ramadan special for. Also, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, أفضل الصيام ثلاثة من كل شهر. When Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As came to ask him, what should I fast? I like to fast. He told him, at the first thing, fast 3 days a month, which are the white, they call them the white days in the among the people, or the three middle days of the Islamic lunar calendar, or lunar month, which are the 13th day, the 14th day, and the 15th day of each and every Muslim month. You have 12 months in the year, so you are talking about 3 days each month multiplied by 12, that's 36 days, multiplied by 10 is 360 days, which is a year too. So that's another habit that Ramadan can teach us, to continue the habit of fasting. And subhanAllah, after ending the month of Ramadan and fasting for the whole month, you feel like your body is actually not used to food. Especially in the first days of breaking your fast, you feel that your body is actually aching and is not really stable. Why? Because your body got used to the concept of fasting, and your tummy or your belly got used, digestive system got used to be taking a break from too much food like shoved inside your throat all the day. So let's keep that habit. That's the first thing. The second thing, Ramadan is the month of charity. What is it, charity? My brothers and sisters, charity is not the obligatory zakah that each one of us is required to pay for the 8 categories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala classified in the Quran. Is not that type of categories. This is a voluntary zakah, it's a voluntary sadaqah that's given to those who are in need or those who ask or for the sake of Allah in general. There are 8 categories that you can give this zakah or charities to. Ramadan, as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was described by Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik and Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, كان أجود من الريح المرسلة. And we talked about this in detail as one of the khutbas of Ramadan. So that's a habit that needs to continue. If you give every day, if you give like a plan to yourself, every day I'm going to get a dollar, or every week I'm going to get out a $10 for the sake of Allah and for the sake of Allah alone. And that every week, so in each month around $40, in the whole year you're talking about what? You're talking about $40 multiplied by 12, that's $400 and $480. That's a year, that's nothing. You might get a ticket or you fix your car for that money for a year. So you pledge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I'm going every day, I'm going to get a dollar. Or every week I'm going to get $10 for the sake of Allah, and to follow the example of a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he talked about 7 people, very special people in the day of judgment, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will specify them to be covered and to be shaded by the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the day of judgment when there is no other shade. One of them, وَرَجُلٌ تَصَدَّقَ صَدَقَةً فَأَخْفَاهَا حَتَّى لَا تَعْلَمُ شِمَالُهُ مَا أَنْفَقَتْ يَمِينُ. One of the people that will be shaded from the 7 categories of people in the day of judgment, that someone get out a sadaqah for the sake of Allah, put that sadaqah in his right hand, close it very carefully, put it for the destination, or put it in the destination where that person is putting the sadaqah, to the point that his left hand, if it has eyes, will not see what's in the right hand. That type of like, that person is so careful that nobody sees his or her own sadaqah, because it's only and solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's number 2. Number 3, we can learn from Ramadan the habit of community and family and connection to people. Ramadan, my brothers and sisters, is a time that we start being reflective in everything around us. Be reflective in how to connect with our families. And in some cultures, people, when Ramadan comes, they become more drawn to connect with their families, their friends, the one that they actually do not talk to, the one that are giving them hard time, and all of these things. So by the end of Ramadan, that doesn't end. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man arada an yutil Allahu fi umrihi wa yubarik lahu fi rizqihi falyasil rahimah." Okay, ma qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whoever wants to increase the length of their life and to increase the blessings of the rizq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we talked about rizq in details before. By saying rizq, my brothers and sisters, is not only money, is not only wealth. My rizq can be far, it's not can be, it's actually far deeper than a bunch of amount of money that you put them in your bank account, you put them in your table or in your safe somewhere. The rizq, my brothers and sisters, when you look at the faces or the eyes of your children, can be, you are so happy and pleased with them. The rizq is that you wake up in the morning finding your body healthy and you have enough food for the day and you are safe in your place. That's a rizq. As the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man asbaha mu'afa fi badanihi 'indahu qut yawmihi." Mu'afa fi badanihi 'indahu qut yawmihi. Aminan fi sirbihi faka'annama haza ad-dunya bima fiha. Whoever wakes up in the morning healthy, safe, and have enough food for the day, that person as if he or she has the whole world in their hand. That's a type of rizq. That's number 3. See, we talked about fasting, charity and connection with our families. That needs to continue. It needs to continue because as Muslims, we're required the whole year to continue this. But Ramadan is that, like that booster that gives us enough energy to continue working according to this habit or this style or lifestyle for the year along, inshallah. That's number three. Number four is Ramadan is the month of the Quran. Is the month of the Quran. Do not come in the day of judgment. The Quran comes to you and say, Ya Rabb, O my Lord, this person left me until I got really dusty. Open the Quran. Open the Quran. Always open the Quran and learn something from the Quran. Because the distance that you keep yourself longer, the distance is from the Quran, farther you are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever takes a step towards Allah, Allah takes 10 steps to him. And whoever walks towards Allah, Allah runs towards him. But how you are actually taking steps far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this advice is needed for all of us, including myself and first and foremost for myself. That in Ramadan we feel more drawn that we need to open the Quran, we need to read the Quran. We need even to strive to do a lot of jihad to connect with the Quran. But once Ramadan is over, the Quran is over, connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always needed. Listen to the Quran. Read the Quran, which is more rewarded. Because by reading, you are actually moving your tongue by the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Connect with the Quran even a page one day. Every day a page. The Quran has around 600 pages, 30 parts, around 240 quarters, has ruba. So if you're talking about a page a day, that by the end of the year, you finish the Quran one time. If you talk about a page and half, a page and quarter, a page and two lines, a page a day does not take more than 5 minutes. In 24 hours during the day. I'm talking about the minimum. A page a day, learn from it something. Get the page and see what you can learn for that day. Wake up in the morning, make wudu, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, open the Quran, read a page or two, and see what you can learn from these two pages that you can work accordingly in that day. And each day like this. That's the Quran. So we talked about the siyam, fasting, charity, connecting with our families, the Quran. What was special about Ramadan other than this? What was special about Ramadan other than this? The self-consciousness or the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the day. This is why when the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in asbaha ahadukum in ahadin qatalahu aw shatamahu falyaqul, inni sa'im, twice. So fasting is a time for being self-conscious or being conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's presence in our life. That's the same thing. This is why some of the ulama, they was teaching their students and saying, whenever you feel like you're very weak and you're about to do some mistakes, say, Allahu shahidi, Allahu muttali'un alay, Allahu raqibi. Allah is witnessing me, Allah is watching me, Allah is observing me. Feeling that inside ourselves, if we do one mistake, we wouldn't do the second. If we do the second, we wouldn't do the third. If we do three mistakes, we will be unhappy with what we're doing. And that's a healthy way by moving towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters, these are practices. They're not just like a speech that we say, and then we hear it, and then we feel good, and then we move on, and then we forget. These are practices that they need repeated actions and the practices all the time, so your body keep being healthy and your soul being healthy until the last moment that we breath our last breath in this life. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم. إن الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونستعين ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا إنه من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ولن تجد له وليا مرشدا. My brothers, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described الأرض المباركة, the blessed land, there are certain lands that have been blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. Like, for example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described in the tongue of the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, when he invited his family from Al-Ard al-Mubarakah, from the blessed land, which is modern-day Palestine, he welcomed them to Egypt and told them, "Idkhulu Misra, insha'Allahu, amineen." That's one of the lands that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed. And also when the Prophet Musa alayhi salam told them, when he told the people of Israel, when they asked him to put for him thawm and different types of food, he asked them to go to Egypt. That's one of the lands. Also another land is the land of Mecca, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it haraman amina, alam numakkin lahum haraman aminan yatakhatafu an-nasu min hawli. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed also a land, blessed the land of Medina. So in that land, there's something special about that land. And as we said in Ramadan, we said one of the conversations we had with the other imams, it's a live conversation on Facebook, we said, usually the deeds are multiplied and more blessed by the time and the land and the efforts that have been exerted in that deed. Three types of things that make your deed more multiplied than other deeds. What are they? Is how much effort you're putting in that deed. عَلَى قَدْرُ الْمَشَقَّةِ تَأْتِ الْعَزَائِمُ فَاصْبِرُ. This is why we're required always to be patient, and the patience is type of azm, times of like determination. And the second thing is the land that you're doing that deed in. Like we said, when we pray in al-Masjid al-Haram, which is equaling 100,000 times in Mecca of a regular prayer, or in al-Madinah, regulars 1,000 times, and in al-Masjid al-Aqsa in Jerusalem, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala free Jerusalem from the persecutors, this is a 500 times. And the third one, that when the time of that deed is actually more blessing, when we do something in Ramadan is more multiplied, more blessed than other days. When we do something in Laylatul Qadr, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Laylatul Qadr khayrun min alfi shahr. So, we talked last Jum'ah about Al-Quds, the Jerusalem, and we talked about Palestine, and we talked about the persecution that has been taking place, not today, since 1917, or even before this, especially in 1897. 1897, when the first conference of Zionism had been established, calling that land to be the land for everyone to go there, all the Jews to go there as a national land for them. And people have been persecuted. Imagine that in 1917 there was also a protest and being persecuted. And 1920 had been a protest and persecuted. And 1929, and 1930, and 1936, and 1947, and 1948, and 1956, and 1967, and 1973. All of these history of persecution does not start from today. But the awareness need to come to the highest level of today. Talk to the children like this, about this place. Because that place, as a human, you're required to be calling injustice. We're required as Muslims to always stand for the sake of justice. As the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Unsur akhaka zaliman aw madhluma." Support your brother, whether they are the ones who are causing injustice or the ones that are being persecuted by injustice. So the Sahaba, the companion, said, "Ya Rasulullah, we know how to support, naturally. All of us, we know how to support the ones that are being persecuted. What about if my brother is the one that causing persecution?" He said, "Takuffuhu an dhulmi." You stop them from what they are doing. So when we are Muslims talking about the extremists that pretend or say or claim that they are Muslims, we tell them that you are not, simply because they're causing injustice and stopping them and even fighting them. And they call La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, but they cause bloodshed in the land. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا جَزَاءُ الَّذِينَ يَحَارِبُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. What they do? And تُقَطَّعَ أَيْدِيَهُمْ وَأَرْجُلُهُمْ مِنْ خِلَافُ وَنِيُوْ يُنْفَوْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. So it's a part of being in the place or in the side of justice and the side of fairness, is to always supporting those who have been persecuted, even if they are not Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, Surah Al-Ma'idah, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kunu qawwamina lillahi shuhada'a bil qist. Be fair and be steadfast For the sake of Allah and the truthful witnesses. For what? وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ عَلَىٰ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا اعْدِلُوا هُوَ أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. And do not be driven by enmity, animosity, and hatred towards someone to stand against their side. If your enemy has been persecuted, you need to stand for your enemy, because the Quran asks you, do not be driven by animosity towards that person to justify that they're being persecuted. Imagine that the third holy place in Islam has been tarnished. It's really sad. See, it's sad to see the carpets full of trash and bombs and the tear gas, and it's not a regular masjid like this. It's the regular masjid itself, it should be like kind of like a place of sanctity and a place of sanctuary, a place of safety. Imagine the third holy place when the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to, and when the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam left to heaven from that place, and when the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam led the other prophets in that exact place. When you walk in it, you imagine like, who's the prophet? This is why the ulama said, whenever you walk, some of them went to the extreme and said, when you walk in Jerusalem, walk with your foot bared. Do not take off your shoes. Because in this land, there's so many blessings and so many prophets and so many righteous people have been walking in that place. When the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا مَثَلِي وَمَثَلُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ قَبْلِي كَمَثَلُ رَجُلٍ بَنَى بَيْتًا فَأَحْسَنَهُ وَزَيَّنَهُ إِلَّا مَوْضُعُ لَبَنَهُ. The example of myself, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, the example of himself and the example of the rest of the prophets is like someone built a really beautiful house, finished it very well, except a place for a brick. So when the people walk and see the house, they say, how beautiful if this house, if that brick has been put in its place. There's only missing one brick. And said, I am the brick and I'm the seal of the prophets. So the connection between all the prophets to that type of masjid that has been tarnished, and people walking with their shoes on, and people like destroying everything holy in that place, makes all of us as Muslims to be driven to that place. That's the place, as my brothers and sisters, and I said it last Jum'ah, that's the place that you prepare yourself and prepare your luggage to migrate, not to migrate, to visit and do pilgrimage to. لا تشد الرحال إلا لثلاث مساجد. And there are the three holy places in Islam, the most three holy places, Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca, and the Masjid Al-Nabi in Medina, and Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem, in Palestine. So we talked about this. And some of us probably have the power of talking. Some of us have the power of acting. Some of us have the powers of لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. So as we said last Jum'ah, use your own assets. But learn yourself about the history of that place. Is not that really golden doom. That's not Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. That's a small portion of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. That's the place when the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did the Mi'raj. It's called the Masjid of Qubbat al-Sakhra. The Masjid of the Doom of the Rock. What is that rock? It's the rock that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood on before he went to heaven. That's a small part of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. But there's another part called Al-Bab Al-Gharbi. And there's another one called Al-Masjid Al-Qibli. And there's another one, it's around the thousands of acres of that place that you need to learn about that place. And you need to teach your children and give them lessons and give them pictures and show them the monuments that stand until today. This place, by the way, was set on fire before. Do you know this? They tried to set that place on fire. Many, many times, they've been building or actually digging canals underneath the place for years and years and years. If you go there, if you have ever been there, you will learn that you have the right as an American citizen to go to that place over the right of the true people that live in the same city, probably feet away from that place. They have to take almost like a visa to go to pray in the masjid. It's far beyond what we think. And it shouldn't be stopped by this. But that's like Ramadan. We said Ramadan is that booster to help us connect to
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala along the day, so make that persecution and that loss of life of almost 60 children and like 20 women, and so many men are being persecuted and bombed in their houses and being persecuted in their houses and being ethnically cleansed of their history and memories. Make that a bolster to help that place and the people live in that place until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala frees it. And don't forget the power of dua. And the last thing, not least, inshallah, don't be driven by the persecution that happened from Zionism to be anti-Semitic and to be against the Jews. Our brothers and sisters who are Jewish, we are not pushed to hate, but we are against the persecution from the Zionists who take out lands, cleanse people history, and destroy and tarnish and disrespect our holy places. Do not be anti-Semitic, and do not lay jrimannakum shana'anu qawmin ala alla ta'dilu, i'dilu, be just, huwa aqrabu للتقوى, that's closer to piety. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا. اللهم حرر مسجدك الأقصى. اللهم حرر مسجدك الأقصى. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في الأرض. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان. اللهم أربط على قلوبهم. اللهم أربط على قلوبهم. اللهم أيدهم بنصرك يا رب العالمين. اللهم إنهم ضعفاء فقوهم. اللهم إنهم قلة فكثرهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم ازرع في قلوب أعدائهم الخوف منهم يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم ازرع في قلوب أعدائهم الوهن يا رب العالمين. اللهم أكرم نزلنا ووسع مدخلنا وعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم. وأقم الصلاة.